I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Would you bow with me in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we pause this morning to look to Thee in thankfulness. Lord, thankful for our land and our freedom, thankful for our heritage and our history. We're thankful for the men and women who have led us in the right way. Lord, we pray for our government this morning, our president, and all those who work around him. May they honor Thee in their policies and decisions. We pray for Thy blessing upon our school and our community. Guide our cadets as they prepare for life and leadership. Bless our superintendent and our guests as they bring encouragement and instruction this morning. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. At this time, Superintendent of Howe Military Academy, Colonel James Benson.
Good morning, cadets.
Good morning, sir.
Commander Leonard Haidl, U.S. Navy, retired. A native of Cologne, Michigan, Commander Haidl graduated from Eastern Michigan University with a Bachelor of Science degree in physics. He was designated a naval aviator in August 1994 and completed his first sea tour in the E-2C Hawkeye aircraft, later commissioning to the F-14 Tomcat. He served on the USS Dwight D. Eisenhower and the USS John F. Kennedy in support of Operations Deny Flight in 1996, Operation Southern Watch 1996 to 2000, and Enduring Freedom in 2002. He later served as an instructor pilot and assistance operations officer at VF-101. Subsequently, he served as a VF-103 department head in support of Operation Iraqi Freedom, later transitioning to the F-18 to the F-18 Foxtrot Super Hornet. He served as the training officer and the operations officer for VFA-106. He received follow-on orders to Carrier Air Wing 3 aboard the USS Harry S. Truman. Commander Haidl is a graduate of the Industrial College of the Armed Forces, a top-level school of the U.S. military. He also earned an Executive Master of Business with distinction from the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California in 2008. He graduated with the Thomas R. McClellan Award for Academic Excellence in the Graduate School of Business and Public Policy. Presently, Commander Haidl is the Executive Officer of the University of Michigan Naval Reserve Officer Training Program that commissions 20 or so Navy and Marine Corps officers of the year, each year. Please give a warm Howe Military Academy welcome to a distinguished naval leader, naval aviator, and scholar.
Morning, everyone. How are you?
Good morning, sir.
It's really odd to be back here. I grew up about 40 miles north of here, just on the other side of Sturgis. And when I was in high school, we played Howe Military in basketball and football. And I have this vision of the gymnasium, the old gymnasium that you have, being out there and sweating and seeing the cadets up in the stands. And there's a certain aura about Howe Military Academy when we played them. I don't remember if we won or lost, but I do remember I had about 55 points that day. So I'm at the tail end of my military career. Loved it almost every second of my career in the Navy, the flying, but more importantly, leading folks. And as I look back now on the people and the places and the things that helped shape me into the aviator and the leader that, I became, a couple things stick out. And now that I'm back at the University of Michigan where I started my career, I had this flashback of a scene that happened when I was a midshipman. We were doing a platoon run in the Naval ROTC. We have Navy and Marine Corps future officers, and we were preparing our Marines to go to officer candidate school. It's a pretty arduous summer for between your junior and senior year, where the Marines test your mettle to see whether or not you can be a leader of Marines. And pretty much the entire junior year, you are preparing to go to OCS. And well, that day, it was a little bit of, I won't say hazing because we can't say that anymore, but there was a harassment package going on where the Marines were all in their packs and they were at the front of the platoon, and our Marine major at the time would say, hey, run to the back of the platoon and ask so-and-so what time it is, or do they have a pen? And they were just doing this over and over again, going from the front of the platoon to the back of the platoon. And I remember stopping in the woods, and our Marine major at the time was correcting rather forcefully one of the Marine officers midshipmen. And he asked me what time it was. He was trying to make a point about being on time. And the young man didn't have a watch. And of course, that sent the major into a tirade, and he forcefully told him that a good officer always wears a watch. Well, it didn't mean much to me at the time, but as I've grown older and I had this flashback, I started thinking, well, is that true? Does a good officer need to have a watch? I thought about it. And of course, it makes sense, right? In the military, in life, in business, here at Howe Military Academy or any school, we have a battle rhythm and a drum beat that is predicated on time. You have to be in formation on time. You have to be in class on time. The TPS report has to be signed on time. Whatever it is, there's something that has to do with time. So it only makes sense that we have a watch to make sure that we are following that battle rhythm. All right, the major was right. And then I thought of it differently as I started getting some business education, that as individuals, individually, your most valuable resource is time. You only have 1,440 minutes a day to do whatever it is that you're supposed to do, whatever you're supposed to accomplish that day. You only have a finite amount of time. You can't get more time, right? Ops research and business study tells us that when we have a constrained resource, which time is, that you should have measurements and controls in place to understand where that time is going, or where that resource is going, how you're using it, how you can use it more efficiently, effectively to accomplish the mission that you're asked to accomplish. So from theory and academic standpoint, it makes sense. We should have a watch to understand where our time is going, how we can do what we're supposed to do in the most efficient, effective manner. And when you came here to Howe, and certainly when the students come to University of Michigan, and certainly if you go into the military, you are going to be asked to do more than you think is humanly possible in that 1,440 minutes a day. But if you start measuring it, start seeing where you're wasting the time, figure out how to use your time better, become more efficient at studying, become more efficient at writing, you're going to realize you can do more and more with your time because you put control measures in place. So from that standpoint, it makes sense that a good officer or a good leader should wear a watch, because we all have a management function. You're going to be put in charge of a process or people that you're trying to get them to accomplish something that can be measured with an instrument. We should wear watches because we are management or managers of a process. But then I was thinking again through my business studies and my ops research that they say you should never schedule your most valuable or constrained resource to 100%. It is a recipe for failure that if you schedule something at 100% for any length of period of time, you're inviting failure to come into that system. I'm thinking about that, and I reflect, I don't know if you've watched the news or listened to the news from this last year, but the United States Navy has had a very bad year this year for accidents. Specifically in the Pacific Fleet, we've had two major ship collisions that have cost 27 sailors their lives. All of those incidents were preventable. All of of those accidents were caused by human error, and all of those accidents had to do with people being overscheduled or more focused on what the time and their timepiece was saying than doing the mission successfully and safely. So in that standpoint, maybe we should have a watch, or at least have it, but not make it be the determinant of our success. I'll give you one example. The U.S. John McCain was a ship that was operating out in the Pacific Fleet. They were supposed to provide an air screen for the aircraft carrier that was operating. They had a specific time and location that they were supposed to be next to the carrier at that time in that location. That was their mission. The crew was qualified. As a matter of fact, they actually had a couple crew members from another ship that came on board. Similar ships, similar systems, they were supposed to be good to go. Those other folks were coming over so they could get some practice being at sea because their ship was in the yards and they couldn't actually get the at sea time. So on board the ship when, just real quick, none of you have been on the bridge of a ship. There's a person called the helmsman. He has the steering wheel and the throttle. Normal conditions, you have one person steering the ship and operating the gas just like we drive a car, right? When things start getting, if the sea state's bad or there's a lot of extra traffic around, they say that's too much for one person, so we're going to split that station. One person is going to be have the wheel in their hands, the other person is going to have the throttle in their hands because it's too much for one person to do when we get busy. So that night of the accident, it was one of those nights. The sea state was bad and there was a lot of traffic in this specific area. The commanding officer said, hey, let's split the helm. We're gonna have a lee helm doing the throttle and the helmsman doing the rudder. Both of those were supposed to be qualified. They're very similar systems, but what was different, although the hardware was the same, the software was different. And nobody took the time to say, oh, you're qualified on that, check. They'd actually ask the question or go in to say, you were using Windows 8 and it's now Windows 10? That's Windows still, but there's differences, right? In those operating systems. So the buttons that you click on one system aren't the same buttons you click on the other. The drop-down panels are different. Some of the verbology is different, but nobody took the time to find out if that was true. So, skipper says, hey, let's split the helm. They said, okay, we're gonna split the helm. I know how to do it. I go into this. A second, that menu isn't what I'm used to. And instead of right then and there, the person standing up and having the courage to say, I don't know how to do this because this isn't what I'm used to seeing, they tried to fix it themselves without bringing it to attention. And by flipping around and clicking the wrong buttons, they actually took away all steering control and throttle control on the bridge. Can you imagine that? You have this pretty big warship out there, and the two main things that you can control to tell it where and how fast it's going, you've just disabled. Again, nobody said, it's time to stop, because I need to be over there to protect the carrier at a certain time in a certain spot, and if we stop right now, I'm not gonna make it. Nobody took the time to stop. Well, now the deck crew, the senior people on the deck said, something's wrong with my ship. I can't tell it where to go or how fast to go. And still, nobody stepped in to say, let's stop. Instead, they all started trying to fix the problem. Can you imagine there's 10 people on the bridge of a Navy warship or this warship? They were all focused on how to fix that one terminal. So not only could they not control the ship, there's two propellers on this type of vessel. One wasn't working, the left one wasn't going, but the right one was turning. So that is going to make you turn left. I don't have a rudder to counteract that. So the whole time this thing is going on, I got a ship that's turning left. The whole time that everybody's trying to fix it, nobody was looking out to see that there was a fishing vessel coming up from the left side who had the right of way, and the naval vessel turned left in front of it and caused an impact. 17 sailors drowned because there was a huge hole in the side of the ship and seawater rushed in and they were below decks and there's nothing we could do to save them once the accident happened. All of that happened because we were more worried about being at a certain spot and place on time. This was our measure of success instead of doing our job safely and according to regulations. And nobody had the courage to stand up and say, this is the way. So the major was wrong. Well, I guess he was right. We should have a watch, but it shouldn't be our primary determinant of what success is. But the major was wrong. If we think about it, our job as leaders isn't just to be manage a process or resources. Our job as leaders is to actually lead people. And as a leader, your most valuable resource isn't time, it's people. And success in that endeavor has nothing to do with time. If you're in trouble, do you care if it takes me 5 minutes or 5 hours to get the solution? You just want to get to the solution. So our success shouldn't be measured on the number of man hours that I put into helping you. When one of you, the people that you're charged with overseeing, is in trouble, it doesn't matter if it's 5 in the morning or 5 at night. They need your assistance. But we can't say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm off the clock right now. I'll be in at 8 o'clock to fix your problem. They need attention now, and that's our charge as leaders, is to make ourselves available to those that we're in charge of so we can help. Our outcome, we should be more concerned with outcomes, positive outcomes for our followers, than we should on the amount of time we spent doing something. I use a sea story that I have to help bring this point home. 2004, we're supporting the Marines in Fallujah as they were, Al-Qaeda had taken Fallujah again, and in November the Marines were going to do a big push to get through and retake the city of Fallujah, which is west of Iraq. We were operating on the Northern Arabian Gulf off the John F. Kennedy. We would fly about an hour and a half up to Fallujah, spend 3 hours supporting the troops on the ground, and then fly another hour and a half back to the ship. That particular day in November of 2004, I was leading a section, so I was flying at a F-18 wingman who was with me. We check in, the Marines needed some ordnance on the deck. My wingman expended his ordnance and then went about 15 minutes away to the tanker to get some gas so he could come back and help support. While he was gone, not much was going on. We were just flying overhead Fallujah, and our last 5 minutes or so, and I'm getting ready to head to the tanker so we can actually head back to the ship to make our recovery time. On aircraft carriers, there's about a very small window every hour that you can actually land on the carrier. I had a spot that I had to meet, and I had to hit a tanker so I could get enough gas to make it back to the ship on time. Well, the person that we've been coordinating with the entire time calls me on the radio, and something has changed. His voice is much different. There's an urgency. You can tell something is going on, and they're in extremis down there. The Marines that he was in charge of was taking fire from a specific building in the southeast part of Fallujah, and they needed us to put ordnance on it to neutralize that threat. Take a look, I have about enough time and about enough gas to deliver the weapons that he's asking for before I need to hit the tanker so I can make it back to the ship on time. Everything's all set, we're about 15 miles away. When we deliver the ordnance, we're going about 550 miles an hour. We're heading down. The weapons that we're delivering, there's about a 0.2 nautical mile distance that if I need to deliver my weapon, hit the little pickle button, what we call it, the release button, in about a 0.2 mile range. And when you're going 600 miles an hour, that would apply in a heartbeat, right? So anyhow, we're inbound 550 miles an hour, have our targeting pod, we have the right building, the right part of the building, the right window in the building, all picked out, we are ready to go. We're about 20 seconds away from delivering one. And he calls back up and emphatically says, I need you to wait a minute. Can you wait just 1 minute? I need another minute. We don't have a count of everybody. Just delay a minute. I'm flying a 54,000 pound piece of metal at 500 miles an hour. It's not easy to figure out how to delay a minute because I only have a small window over the space that I need to deliver my weapons from. But I'm a really good pilot, so I figure it out. Figure out what I'm going to do, the maneuver that I have to do, because if I do a big turn, I'm going to lose acquisition of the target, so the targeting pod is not going to be able to see the target anymore. I'm going to spend a bunch of energy, so I have to figure out how to get that energy back on, get the speed back on, get target acquisition and deliver my weapons. But I do it. Come back around, reacquire the target, get the speed back up, which takes a lot of throttle, which is burning gas, which is burning time. We get everything out, and he calls me back again. 15 seconds prior to hitting the button. We got everybody but one guy. Can you wait another minute? And now the airplane is telling me you're going to run out of gas. I have a little light that's flashing and says, you're not crazy low yet, but it's a concern. My time to make it back to the ship is starting to, like, I don't know if I can make it. If I get enough gas, I can go fast enough to make it, but I need to get gas. The tanker that I'm supposed to hit is 15 to 20 minutes away. All right, get up in a minute here, start worrying. All the while, you know, we're still flying around trying to figure out what it is. So we call the tanker, hey, can you come to me instead of me going to you? All right, that's gonna work. All the while, we're doing this high octane turn to get ourselves set back up, delaying the minute while we're doing all this, getting energy back, getting the target acquired, making sure we're in the right space, going the right heading. Everything's coming back. The tanker said he's gonna go max speed to come meet us. So I'm like, okay, we can do this one more time. Head back in, same thing. Just about ready to hit the button. And he says, we got everybody except for one. I need one more minute. And I'm really in a conundrum because my plane's telling me you're running out of gas or you're gonna run out of gas soon. I have rules that say I'm not supposed to be doing what I'm doing with this little gas. So I have that rule, but I also have somebody yelling for me. They're in extremis, and I can help that person. So I have to violate one of these two things. But I chose to violate the one that says I'm not supposed to be doing this anymore because I don't have enough fuel. But I knew my system well enough. I knew my fuel reserves. I knew where I was going to go in case the tanker didn't show up or I couldn't get in or he didn't have the gas to give me. I had all this planned out, so I was saying, I'm comfortable making that excursion from standard policy because these people are going to die if I don't do what I'm supposed to do. So I come back around, I'm doing my run, I'm stroking the afterburners now to get the jet up to speed, and the no kidding low fuel light comes on. Just as we are getting to this point, we're supposed to deliver the weapon, we deliver it, the weapon impacts. We immediately gave it to the tanker that was right where they were supposed to be, got gas, and everything worked out well. So if I had let the watch dictate what my success was going to be, it would have been 15 minutes before another airplane arrived to help those Marines. And if you've talked to anybody who's been in a firefight or on the ground when they're receiving fire, 15 minutes is a lifetime or an eternity. I prioritized helping somebody else because I knew my system well enough that I could make excursion for pops. I was more concerned with the outcome than I was with the time that was on my watch. So in that regard, the major was wrong. We should be more concerned with outcomes than we are when we're leading people. We should be more concerned with outcomes than we are with the time it takes us to accomplish that outcome. So, have a watch, because we in the military, in the Western world, in the business world, operate to a drumbeat and to a battle rhythm that is predicated on time. But never let time be your sole measure of success, especially when you're leading people. Positive outcomes for those people should be your measure of success. I want to say one more thing that is not associated with wearing a watch, but it's something that at the University of Michigan and through the entire enterprise of officer development in the United States Navy and Marine Corps we're having trouble with. In the last 6 months, we've had 15 suicides. That's a pretty big number. We've had 200 sexual assault or harassment cases, and we've had 20 DUIs. Hopefully nobody here is driving or drinking on that. But the part of it that really strikes me is the number of people that are choosing to commit suicide. So I looked at a bigger number and looked at the CDC, Center for Disease Control's number on leading causes of death for 15 to 24 year olds. So kind of the body that I deal with, and most of you fall into that. Number one killer is motor vehicle accidents. Number two is homicide. And number three is drug overdose. Number four is suicide by firearms. Number five is suicide by suffocation. So three of the top five have something to do with people not feeling a place in this world, not feeling connected, and are looking for an escape. I'm saying, look around at this family that you have, these 88 cadets that you have, or the 93 midshipmen that I have at the University of Michigan. In this family, we should be engaged with each other to let you know that you have worth. There's something special about you that you is worth further development and getting the help that you need. And if this family doesn't do it, think about something bigger. Does anybody here plan on going to the military after they get out? You know what every military member has in common? We stand up and we raise our right hand and we say we're going to support and defend the Constitution of the United States. That is something that unites us all. We are all teammates in that endeavor to support and defend the Constitution of the United States. So therefore, your well-being should be important to me. Your teammates' well-being should be important to you. Does anybody know the preamble of the Constitution of the United States? Come on up. Stand up and say it.
We, the people of the United States of America, love this
one. Anybody know the more? Anybody want to try? We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish the Constitution of the United States. That is a mission statement that binds us all. Every citizen of our country has a part in that mission to make a more perfect union. Whether you believe it or not of yourself, you play a role in making a more perfect union. Our teammates, the citizens of our country, have a role in making a more perfect union, so that should make me care about your well-being because you contribute to the puzzle of making a more perfect union. So I hope you take solace in that and find that you and your teammates all have worth in contributing to forming a more perfect union. Whether you choose to support and defend, or you just go out and be a productive citizen of our country. Because if you haven't noticed, if you haven't looked in the news, I encourage you to do so. I would say the state of Indiana, or wherever you're from, needs your best. The United States military, Navy, Army, Air Force, or Marine Corps, we need your best. And the country as a whole needs the best that you can offer. So hopefully that encourages you to become your best, develop yourselves as the best student, leader, and citizen that you can be at your time here at Howe Military Academy. And if anybody's interested in coming to the University of Michigan as a Naval ROTC midshipman, I'll be around. I'd love to talk to you about that. But I leave with it. So good leaders should wear a watch, but don't let that determine your success. Thank you.